three, two, one, and liftoff. Liftoff of the 25th Space Shuttle mission, and it has cleared the tower.
It was an unusually cold morning on January 28, 1986, when Challenger flew its 10th mission.
Big smiles today.
This launch attracted more media attention than usual since it carried the first American civilian, a teacher.
I am so excited to be here.
NASA selected Krista McAuliffe out of 11,000 applicants. She was planning to give lessons to students while in orbit. The mission was also supposed to deploy a satellite and observe Halley's Comet for several days, but the crew never made it. Just 73 seconds after launch, an entire nation watched what unfolded in horror.
1 minute 15 seconds, velocity 2900 feet per second. Flight controllers here looking very carefully at the situation. Obviously a major malfunction.
NASA's ground crew knew that no one could have survived. And the Challenger engineers feared this would happen and tried to stop the launch, like Bob Ebeling, who worked for the contractor responsible for the shuttle's boosters, Morton Thiokol. I spoke with his daughter, Leslie, who also worked at the company.
What did your father say to you the day of the launch?
It's going to explode. Everyone is going to die. And the only way I could have stopped this was if I had gone home, gotten my rifle, and gone out there and held everyone hostage. And I said, Dad, they would have thrown you right into jail.
Contrary to an initial report by NASA, the crew knew immediately that the spacecraft was in trouble. Analysis of the tape recordings revealed the pilot uttered, uh-oh, just before a fireball ended all communication. The Challenger broke up 48,000 feet above the Atlantic, while the crew cabin continued to soar to 65,000 feet. It's almost certain the astronauts survived the initial breakup, as they were able to switch on at least three emergency breathing packs. The agency said they probably remained conscious for at least 6 seconds, if not longer, depending on how fast the crew compartment lost pressure. NASA also couldn't rule out the possibility that they may still have been alive when the crew cabin hit the water at 207 miles per hour, or 333 kilometers an hour. The seven souls on board were Ellison Onizuka, the first Asian American to fly into space, Krista McAuliffe, Gregory Jarvis, a payload specialist on his first journey into space. Judith Resnick was the second American woman to go into orbit. It was pilot Mike Smith's first flight as an astronaut. Next to him is the commander of the space shuttle, Dick Scobie. Ron McNair was the second African American to reach space. The entire failure could be traced to the rubber gasket sealing the booster joints, called O-rings. The investigation found that the O-rings weren't working as designed. Normally, they're supposed to prevent hot gases from leaking, but the cold weather caused both the primary and backup O-rings in the right solid rocket booster to stiffen, so they failed to stop the gases from escaping, leading to the catastrophic accident. The ambient temperature that day was 36 degrees Fahrenheit, or 2 degrees Celsius, rare for Cape Canaveral, Florida. The space shuttle was never certified to operate in such low temperatures. Ebeling sounded the alarm to his boss, an engineer named Alan McDonald, who tried to stop the flight by refusing to sign the launch recommendation the night before. Another engineer, Roger Beaujolais, was also concerned. He noticed O-ring stiffening from a previous launch and warned his superiors in a memo 6 months earlier that if left unaddressed, the result could be a catastrophe of the highest order, loss of human life. At first, the managers at Morton Thiokol agreed with their engineers and wouldn't approve the launch, but NASA challenged that recommendation. George Hardy, the NASA official who supervised Morton Thiokol's production of the boosters, famously said he was appalled when told the flight should be postponed. The engineers recalled another NASA manager saying, "My God, Thiokol, when do you want me to launch? Next April?" The flight had already been delayed several times, and the space shuttle program had ambitiously planned 15 missions that year. Plus, President Ronald Reagan reportedly planned to tout the Challenger mission during his State of the Union address that very day. In the end, the bosses at Morton Thiokol changed their minds and signed off on the launch despite the concerns of their own employees. When the space shuttle cleared the launch pad, Ebeling braced himself while watching in a conference room at work.
Everyone kind of sighed in there, like a relief, and Dad just bent down and he said, "We're not finished yet." And I was just like, "Oh no," and bam.
RSO reports vehicle exploded. Copy.
The disaster forced President Reagan to postpone his address to Congress. He would instead deliver a somber speech to the nation.
We come together today to mourn the loss of 7 brave Americans, to share the grief that we all feel, and perhaps in that sharing to find the strength to bear our sorrow and the courage to look for the seeds of hope. Sometimes when we reach for the stars, we fall short, but we must pick ourselves up again and press on, despite the pain.
President Reagan immediately established a task force to investigate the disaster. Not only did the official report criticize NASA's decision to ignore the engineers, it revealed the agency knew about the O-ring problem as early as a decade before, concluding both NASA and contractor management first failed to recognize it as a problem, then failed to fix it, and finally treated it as an acceptable flight risk. Sociologist and Columbia University professor Diane Vaughn wrote a book examining why NASA allowed such a launch to go ahead. She explained that because earlier cold weather flights with O-ring problems didn't result in disaster, this damage was gradually accepted as normal. She coined the term normalization of deviance. When something that is clearly unsafe comes to be seen as normal if it doesn't immediately cause a catastrophe. In other words, what was not okay slowly becomes okay. When McDonald told his story to the Presidential Commission about how he and the other engineers fought against the launch, he got demoted at work. Congress then passed a resolution that would ban Morton Thiokol from ever acquiring a contract with NASA unless McDonald got his job back. Not only did McDonald get reinstated, he was then put in charge of redesigning the rocket boosters to improve their safety. Most importantly, modifying the seal, which included adding a third O-ring. Besides the physical changes, there was also a profound change in attitude at NASA that resulted in more checks and balances. The agency also created a new accountability office headed by someone who would report directly to NASA's administrator. The disaster grounded the space shuttle program for nearly 3 years. A civilian wouldn't attempt to fly into space again until 2007 on the replacement to Challenger, Endeavour. A teacher also flew this time. Barbara Morgan was the backup to Christa McAuliffe on that tragic mission. Since then, NASA has gone on to score many achievements, completing the International Space Station and landing multiple rovers on Mars. Now, it's partnering with private companies, recently selecting SpaceX to send the next American astronauts back to the moon. Despite the successes, the tragedy of Challenger will never be forgotten. Every year on January 28, NASA holds a day of remembrance to honor the 7 lives lost, as well as the crews of Apollo 1 and Columbia. As for the engineers who tried to stop the launch, Alan McDonald would later travel to universities to speak about the importance of ethical decision-making. He passed away in March of this year. Roger Beaujolais also spoke at schools about ethics for 3 decades. He died in 2012. Bob Ebeling was racked with guilt for 30 years.
He felt like a failure, a total failure.
When NPR interviewed him a few years ago, he lamented, "I think that was one of the mistakes that God made. He shouldn't have picked me for the job. You picked a loser." He then received thousands of letters of support from around the world, letting him know he was far from a loser. He was a hero. Ebeling finally felt vindicated of any wrongdoing. Weeks later, in March of 2016, he passed away after a long illness at the age of 89. This video took a lot of time to put together. And after finishing a story like this, I like to unwind and watch whatever I want. Unfortunately, certain videos aren't available in my region, which is where my sponsor NordVPN comes in handy. I simply click on the NordVPN app, pick a different country, and that changes my IP address so I can watch this video, for example. And by changing your IP address, your online activity can't be traced back to you. If you head to nordvpn.com/newsthink, you'll receive a huge discount on their 2-year plan, plus you get an additional month free. The link is in my description, and don't forget to use my promo code, Newsthink. For Newsthink, I'm Cindy Pom.